Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and joining me this week as usual are Alan Temple.
Hello.
Graeme Finnan.
Hello everyone.
And sick boy George Cran.
Hello.
You feeling better, George?
A wee bit, yeah.
Right.
I'll try my best to get through.
Hope it's not contagious.
Yeah, well, is it contagious?
Oh, I like to be generous with everything in my life.
In that case, let's all move away from George and start with United this week.
No, you'll be fine. You'll be fine. Don't worry.
As I was trying to say there, George, we're starting with United next week, so you can have a wee nap. Okay. Alan, told you they would win at Inverness.
Left it late.
Hey. As long as you scored before the final whistle.
Yeah. No, it was a performance of guts and character and all that good stuff that's required in the championship, particularly in circumstances that were less than ideal. Second successive week that they've had a player sent off. I know there was a little bit of disappointment with the decision. Jim Goodwin thinking the player Charlie Gilmore had made slightly too much of the second booking for Jordan Tilson, but personally I thought both bookings were justifiable. I thought the second challenge 4 minutes after you've just been booked was very, very silly for a player that's 30 years old and has played more than 250 games. I think that's probably where the blame lies, more than Charlie Gilmore making a little bit too much of the challenge. But that gave them a real test going into the final half an hour. And just like against Morton when they lost Matthew Cujo, United merited their win, particularly in the last sort of 10 minutes. Clearly a very fit team. They keep going to the end, and they had a couple of half chances even before Chris Mockery scored. And despite it being one of the ugliest goals you'll ever score, it's a fantastic moment. It would be lovely to go up there and win 5-0 and everybody would be talking about champagne football. But, you guys have all been away fans at games. I think that's probably even more memorable happened. That moment where, fans spilling onto the pitch and real catharsis and real fighting spirit is a moment when fans look back on their travels this season and look back on memorable moments that I think they'll really enjoy. And it builds on that sense of momentum without United being, I would say, anywhere near their best. They are excellent defensively, really, really good. However, I still think they can do a lot more in the final third in terms of creating chances when you look at the 11 players they've got on the pitch. So that in itself is a positive. They've done the structural stuff. They're hard to beat, they're hard to score against, and now you take that and hopefully build a few more sort of attractive performances. But for all that, there's room for improvement. Top of the league, unbeaten in 9, joint best defensive record in league football in Scotland, along with Rangers. There's very little to complain about, even if you could suggest areas in which they could improve.
Yeah, and Bear, as Alan says, 15 minutes to go away from home, you're 3-0 up. As a punter, you're actually starting at times to go, I wonder what time I'll get home tonight. And you're obviously happy, but you're almost moving on from the game. Score an injury time, a winner.
There's no better time to get a goal.
That takes up an hour of the journey, doesn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah,
that's what you're talking about.
And there's quite a few hours on the journey coming back from Inverness, I've got to say. Great result. Any result up at Inverness is a terrific result. And to get it in that manner when you're down to 10 men, I feel like a double victory for Dundee United. But as Alan says, what I'm seeing with Dundee United is based on a defensive solidity. There were obviously a bit of criticism for the goal they lost against Morton, but that's been the one blip, I think, this season. The defence has been outstanding, and you've spoken about it, and they can win the league by October, and that's not going to happen, obviously. But but if they can keep that defensive solidity going throughout the season, they will win the league, and they'll win it with a few games to spare, because they're giving teams no hope of getting goals. And as you can see, they get up the park the other end and they sneak a goal. Jim Goodwin will be absolutely thrilled a bit the way things have gone so far. It's early days, but his side do look the standout side in that division at this point in time. We're only sort of heading towards the start of October, but I'm looking at other teams and you're seeing weaknesses in other teams.
Consistency, isn't
it?
It's always
I'm not seeing any real weakness in the United side. And it's credit to the manager, because he has shuffled up that defence. You know, you see all the new faces, Walton, Grimshaw, Holt, Declan Gallagher. But I noticed that Sybald is back now. I noticed that Doherty plays as well. They give you added strength in steel. That back line. And they're making it very difficult for teams. And, you know, they're top of the league. And, you know, they've just got to keep it going, Tom. They've just got to keep it going.
It wasn't something I was going to mention, but since Bear brings him up there, it is worth a shout out to Craig Sybald, because he was not intended to play 90 minutes. It was his first start in a long time, and down to 10 men. There was a couple of enforced changes in that engine room, and he was running on fumes by the end of that game, but did not stop running, did not stop hearing into tackles, and it was a really gutsy performance from Craig Sybald. But in terms of proper,
which has been the hallmark of his short time so far.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great to have him back. But in terms of the real standouts, and not just on Saturday but this season, Kevin Holt and Declan Gallagher were colossal. They won every single ball in the box. For context, Declan Gallagher made 14 clearances and Kevin Holt made 10 clearances. Between them, 24 clearances. Just numbers without context. But see, the entire Inverness team made 23 clearances.
Maybe the big context about that is, this is Dundee United. This is the best team in the league so far. So you don't expect them to have to make that number.
But you will need to, though, because teams are going to pepper your box. That's what the championship's about. There will be periods under pressure where they're going to be shelling the ball into your box. They're going to be on. And if you've got players that win every challenge, Inverness had to deal with as many entries into their box as Dundee United did. Mm-hmm. The difference is their centre-backs didn't win every single one of them, basically. So it was those two put that partnership as so far and away the best in the league that it's almost to the point where it's a nonsense that it's in the championship. It really is. It's particularly Declan Gallagher, a player that was in the Scotland squad as recently as September 2022. You watch him play and go, a bit silly, really. You know, it's great for Dundee United to have him, but you almost think to yourself, why are you spending a season in the championship? He is that good. He is that dominant.
Yeah. It just popped into my head there when you were saying it's silly. But it seems to be modern football. You've got the boy David De Gea. Goes from Manchester United, number one of Spain international. He's maybe going to retire because he can't get a club that he feels suits his abilities. Now, that's maybe a wee bit arrogant, but it's...
I think it shows the size of his bank balance at this point in time as well.
It does tell the tale. But what I was actually going to say about the point that Alan was making there, George, I don't like to add to your recent illness...
What are you going to ask me?
As a Queen of the South fan who spends his working life covering Dundee, historically you are our championship expert.
Yeah.
And for all it can be a thrilling league. As Alan says, the box gets peppered with balls at both ends in games and stuff like that. But very often the key to the championship is, if you don't make a mistake, the other defence will. And that seems to be where United are coming from this season.
Yeah, well, very much the case. I mean, there's a reason all these players are in the championship.
Yeah.
On the whole, it's because, I mean, you've talked about this plenty of time over the years, that they're good defenders for maybe 88 minutes of the game, and then they have that one mistake, and that's the difference between Premiership and Championship. And it can be the case of just holding your nerve at times and holding the other team out, and then you will get a chance. That seemed to be the way things went up the road.
Yeah.
And United have good players, especially at the top end of the park, that might not be scoring as many goals as they would like, but Moult is scoring most weeks, although he's obviously got that wee knock. But guys like Mochrie stepped up with a goal, Fotheringham stepped up with a goal, Glass has stepped up with a goal.
Cujo,
you've got these boys that United knew there was a lot of talent in, but hadn't really seen it in Tangerine yet, and we're starting to see that. I think that's a really good sign. They need to keep it going.
Last week we spent a big chunk of the United section speaking about our feeling that we could get a lot more from Tony Watt. Mm. And there are other attacking players. We're actually, on this podcast, we're not happy with United attacking. And they're top of the league and looking like they're going to win the league or be very difficult to dislodge, and that's a great place to be at this stage of the season.
Jim Goodwin's philosophy is very much that if they don't give away anything stupid and if they keep a clean sheet, then they have enough in their team,
yeah.
whether it's through their effectiveness at set pieces, whether it's through their natural talent, to score a goal at some point in 95 minutes of football. And so far, that is a strategy that's getting to them to top league. Now, that's not to say that once they're comfortable in their shape and in their structure, you can't then be more expansive. But it's just, it's building blocks. He is building from the ashes of a team that was a shambles last season.
Well, it is a new team, as you mentioned. You went through the back four. Who's left from last season?
Walton wasn't there. Grimshaw wasn't there. So, effectively, Scott McMahon. Yeah. Scott McMahon, and I'll tell you another thing, the Scott McMahon that's playing this season isn't the Scott McMahon from last season. That is effectively a different player given the level of confidence and the level of performance that he's putting in. So there needs to be that initial focus on just being hard to break down, because it's the only way you can build a brand new team. You can't build a team from the front backwards.
No.
It's just not how it works.
And you say the classic way to build a team is from the back forwards. Plus, with United, they were so bad at losing soft goals last season.
Yeah, that's it.
That was the thing you had to address, because it didn't matter how well they were playing going forward. If they were still losing those goals, it would quickly erode confidence, wouldn't it?
This weekend's an interesting one, because I think we can now safely say, you know, as I say, joint best defensive record in Scotland. We can now safely say that structure's there. The boys all know what they're about in terms of not giving away anything daft. Queen's Park coming to town, team hemorrhaging goals. And you would like to think at home, this is a weekend that Dundee United can look at the opposition and say, let's be a bit more expansive. Let's
They'll get
try
chances.
And,
yeah.
Exactly. We should get chances. And whether it's Louis Moult or Tony Watt that plays, I think they should be potentially licking their lips on this one. Yeah. And it's worth saying, because, you know, Tam mentioned him there last week, we devoted a fair amount of time to Tony Watt. And lo and behold, he was indeed on the bench in Inverness. But see, when he came on for 65 minutes, really good. Really, really good. And it was a reminder that, you know, he hasn't been playing in the position that he would primarily like to be playing in.
Yeah.
And when he came on as a number nine, as churlish as it sounds, he did everything except from score.
Is it just a case for Tony Watt, as experienced a player as he is, he needs to go for his confidence?
100%. That's it. That's exactly it. He did. I mean, as I say, it just seems like such a silly thing to say for a number nine, but he did everything except from put the ball in the net. And even then, he went clean through at a tough angle and almost dinks the ball perfectly over Mark Ridgers. Doesn't do an awful lot wrong, but Mark Ridgers makes a really good point blank save. If that goes in, you're looking at a different moment. So, but in terms of leading the line, never stopped running, made blocks, made clever runs, linked up well. He did everything you'd want from the number nine, everything that we've been praising Louis Moult for. He just needs the ball to go for the line. But it was a far, far more heartening performance. And especially after being on the bench, being dropped, the disappointment of that, his attitude when he came on was exactly what you want. It was a, fine, I was on the bench, but here's what I can do when I'm brought on and given the chance.
And I'll say it again. It's exactly as it's always been every time I've ever seen him play. He's got this sort of reputation as maybe it's this thing where he throughout his career, when things weren't working out at a club, he would happily move on quite quickly. But I've never seen any indication in performances by Tony Watt that it means he doesn't try hard when he's on a park. And he does, doesn't he?
When he's on a football pitch, particularly this season under Jim Goodwin, who is a manager who first and foremost values hard running and work ethic, he has lived up to that. And I thought he was good. Tony Watt's biggest problem, as we said last week, is I think his best position is playing as a number nine, and he performed very well as a number nine, but at the moment Dundee United only play one of those,
and he's so the one that's got the ability to play
exactly. You wouldn't put Louis Moult in
behind. Moult scoring the goals. I mean, you need to have number nine scoring goals.
Yeah. It would be very interesting if Louis's not quite 100%. From what I gleaned on and off the record at the start of the week, I probably wouldn't be playing Louis Moult this weekend. I think they could get by without him, and with it being a wee muscle strain, I don't think that's one you want to risk.
You've got Raith Rovers the week after as well.
Exactly. You've got Raith Rovers away the week after. So I would be saying Louis Moult can go on the bench if we need him for the last 15 minutes, so be it. But let's give Tony a reward for the hard work and that he's been doing in an unfamiliar position and the graft that he's been putting in, and giving him a wee crack for a full game starting as lead striker.
And you've got the likes of Declan Glass, last weekend's hero, who can slot in quite comfortably behind Tony Watt. So it's a With actually quite limited resources in terms of numbers up front, Bear, Jim Goodwin's got that ability to shuffle his forward pack a wee bit, doesn't he?
He does a wee bit. I'm listening to what Alan's saying there. I say, take your eye off this championship at your peril. Don't ever write off any team. Queen's Park, obviously, they took a bit of a doing from Air United.
I agree with what Alan's point until I've got to pick the team. It's my job that's on the line. Then you go, managers, I think, sometimes convince themselves it will be okay. That's when they got optimism.
They did take a bit of a battering from Air United, who hadn't been going that great themselves. And notice that Logan Chalmers got a couple of goals. Who have got to say, going off on a tangent here, I watched him against Partick Thistle and I thought he did quite well. Yeah, Logan Chalmers is doing well, yeah. So good to see him doing well. Yeah, watch out for Queen's Park. I mean, they were a whisker away from being promoted last season, winning the actual league. They've got a new manager in, Veldman, Robin Veldman. Interesting to see where they're actually going, but I certainly wouldn't treat them like this. I think what you're saying is right, Tom. I think we spoke about this. It's United being in the championship, while it's a disaster for the club in terms of finance and you know, being out the top flight is opportunities for some of their players. And I think we're seeing that some of them are actually stepping up to the mark now. You're mentioning guys like Mochrie, Glass, Meeks and Fotheringham. And it's they'll be encouraged by seeing their mates of coming out the sort of the youth team and actually being in that first team, and all be vying to do better than each other, which is a great position for Jim Goodwin to be in. But leaving Louis Moult out the team to keep him for next week, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he's fit. I think he starts.
And in general about United, I'm actually biting my lip here, boys. I'll wait after the next two games. But win these two games, I'll be in here with a band. And it will be mid-October, I would point out. But there's, you know what? And like we've said, there's room for improvement going forward. But that's often the case this time of the season with teams. But there's a drive about them, isn't there? There's a determination. There's a steel that seemed to take a year off last year. Because they had it before. They got through games. The close games, they took a point or 3 points. And they seem to be back to doing that again. And that's a big thing.
Yeah, well, last season they kind of did what we said was impossible, which was try and build a team from the front. They signed, spent a fair amount on guys like Stephen Fletcher and Glenn Middleton and Dylan Levitt, who's more comfortable with the ball, and all these guys that are far more comfortable with a football at their feet, and signed nobody by the way of a decent goalkeeper or somebody who can make a tackle. So what you're right, that steal took a year off, almost due to a combination of the team not playing very well, but partly just the personnel not being right, mm-hmm. them not having the right players. So they've signed well during the transfer window in terms of addressing that, and yeah, they've got a steal back and they've got a drive back, but that's in common with quite a lot of teams in the championship. Over the course of the season, it's about not only taking that, but making your quality tell, and there's definitely quality in that final third, and I think that will gradually start to click. It was good to see, Bear mentions Archie Meekerson, it was good to see him get a start. He's a player that when he's on the cusp of starting games, he seems to, you know, either have a wee niggle or he was going to start the SPFL Trust Trophy game against Dunfermline and called up for Scotland under 21 duty and things like that. But I know Jim Goodwin really rates him, and it was a real vote of confidence for him to start instead of Kai Fotheringham with no Matthew Cujo. So, and Archie Meekerson hit the post, had another three shots. No other player had more shots on goal than Archie at the weekend. So chance for him to stake his claim for a jersey. And as Bear says, the guys like Declan Glass have proved that you can do that. Jim will give you the chance to grab a jersey and keep a jersey. So, interesting selection options, because you sit down to pick an 11 for Dundee United, and particularly, I would say, in the midfield and wide areas, there are different shapes and different personnel you can go with. So interesting to see what he goes with at the weekend.
Yeah, just to correct my earlier error, it wasn't Declan Glass who was the hero. Of course, it was Chris Mochrie. Yeah. But
Chris Glass.
I've just United had a season off when it came to steel. This season, I just don't care about names. What's in a name, I say.
Exactly.
But Mochrie again, so often this season, and it's noticeable, these tight games. Young players coming up with a goal. It's great to see.
I remember Chris Mochrie breaking onto the scene. It must have been 10 years
ago. I know.
Pete Rundle was telling me, a good friend, Pete Rundle was telling me about him. It seemed like an eternity ago now, and he's still here. Like so many of these guys, you get the feeling it's now or never for them. I mean, some of them are just breaking in and they'll get a bit of time. But guys like, I think Mochrie and Glass in particular, has got to be this season.
And there is
got
a wee clutch at United that have taken longer, but the signs are good.
Yeah.
Across the road, Finn Robertson had a great sort of impact early on and then had a few seasons struggling. But it's good to see clubs sticking with these guys.
I read a statistic this week, and shamefully I forget the Twitter account it came from, and I feel like I should give them a shout out. It'll have been either the Arab Archive account or the DUFC stats account, so have a look at both of them and see if you see this stat. But it was Chris Mochrie's time between his first goal for the club and second goal for the club was the longest since Hamish McAlpine's first goal for the club and second goal for the club. So that's how long it's been since Mochrie broke into the team and scored his first goal. And you wouldn't think it for such a young player, but
Hamish wouldn't thank you for that, seeing as he was the penalty taker at the time.
So from 16 years old to 20-year-old, we still think of him as such a young man, but he must feel like he's been around forever waiting for this opportunity. Mm. And especially coming back from Dunfermline, where he played a lot of football and won a league title. I know he was really desperate to hit the ground running, and again, another couple of niggles and growing pains and all that sort of stuff as Jim Goodwin looks to bulk these kids up and make them more ready. And hopefully, although his finish was nice and composed late on, I wouldn't necessarily be sure that he's done enough to start the next game, but he's certainly put himself a little bit further up in the pecking order, I would suggest.
And while he let me down badly by not getting that winner last Saturday, Declan Glass, I see that he's now having his longest run in the team.
Yeah, he falls kind of in the same category as Chris Mochrie.
He's a cracking player.
Declan Glass is an outrageously technically gifted footballer. He does things with a footballer that with a football that not
does things with a footballer. That's for our late night podcast.
We're drifting into libelous territory. He does things with a football that not many in the Dundee United squad can. I would say probably him and Matthew Cudjoe, most technically, naturally gifted players there. And his goal against Dunfermline was a great example of that. There's just not many players in the second tier that are capable of that sort of goal. And he's now kind of, I spoke to him after the game at the weekend, and he's really kind of relishing and embracing playing as a normal midfielder, not a floaty in the hole type, just a normal midfielder that can pick the ball up deep, can drive forward, can get forward, can tackle, can just do everything and be properly involved in the game. And I'm really delighted for him, because he's had so many loan spells and injuries, and he's 23 years old now, and he must have, I'm sure, had moments where he thought, do you know what, maybe this isn't going to happen at Dundee United.
Yeah.
And then in the final year of his contract, maybe he's just doing enough to establish himself, and touch wood, if United do go up, then potentially he can become an important player for them in the Premiership. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. But I'm delighted to see a player that's gone through a lot of trials and tribulations get a wee run in the team.
Could just being part of the squad be a great thing for Declan Glass? As Alan says, he's 23 now. We've been speaking about the Cudjoes and the Mochries and others and stuff like that. And maybe, right up until the time I stopped covering games every week, when Declan Glass was coming on or was starting, you were like, here's the young lad. And it does put them apart, and it puts a wee spotlight on them. And maybe just being, he's now Declan Glass, part of Dundee United's first team squad, maybe helps him just get on with things, and he doesn't feel the pressure or the spotlight.
I hope so. That will help. I mean, anywhere Declan Glass has gone in, as Alan said, he's been out on loan quite a few times. Every manager's had good things to say about him.
Yeah.
But he's always still ended up back at Tannadice.
And then put him on the bench.
Yeah, for one reason or another. So he should feel part of the Dundee United squad the length of time he's actually been at the club. But I'm sure he's aware of the situation. He's out of contract, as Alan says, in the summer, So it is, as I've already said, this is a massive season. It's never never for Declan Glass to really stamp his authority. It looks like he's going to be given the opportunity to do just that. And, you know, if Declan Glass can perform at a level we know he can perform at on a consistent basis, you know, it can only be beneficial to Dundee United going forward.
And I see, looking at news elsewhere, poor Mark Berigriti, he's still here. Or is he here?
Is he poor?
I don't think he's poor, but the unfortunate man. He's been very pedantic, hasn't he? Is he actually working with the team, training away?
Yeah, he's still kicking about. Aye. There's not a crazy.
He's running out of windows now, isn't he?
Yeah, it's an image.
It's a darkened room.
I would suggest, yeah, it's probably now January before he moves on. I would suspect that clearly nothing appealed to him in this window or any of the later closing windows in the summer. But come January, he's then in the last 6 months of his deal. He probably doesn't want to be going into the summer where he'll become a free agent, saying to potential suitors, I haven't kicked a ball in a year, because that doesn't put you in a great position. So
some fans would say, hasn't caught a ball in two.
Yeah, so
that was controversial.
Is it? Are there many people out there claiming Mark had a good season last season?
No, I don't think he did.
So I think it would be in his best interest probably in January to get out and show what he can do and fresh start, because
His career.
He can't possibly be as bad as he was last season. It must have been an accumulation of factors, because if he was the standard of goalkeeper that he seemed to be last season, then he wouldn't have had the career he's had. So he needs to go out, get away from Dundee United, get away from the negativity, go out and play his football and earn himself a permanent deal somewhere else come the summer. But it would have been, I think, beneficial for all parties if that could have happened earlier, but he needs to find a move that's attractive in location and financially, as attractive as Dundee United is, and there wasn't one forthcoming.
And before we head over the street, big news from up north. Duncan Ferguson, one-time United starlet. Inverness Cali manager. That was a bit out of the blue, wasn't it? Although,
I'm waiting for Bear to take this one. He'll have more Duncan Ferguson stories.
Yeah, quite a few of them I can't mention on here, I've got to say. Yeah, it was a bit of a stunner, wasn't it? He just suddenly appeared on the scene and he was the manager. There's a few names in the frame. And Duncan,
bold move by him, because Inverness, a club that repeatedly have said over the past couple of years, touch on this last week, that they've not got a lot of money. No. Yeah. It's been a bit of a struggle in recent times for them, and he could have waited for another job to come up.
Three years is bold from Inverness.
Yeah. It is absolutely, and you know, he's obviously up in sticks from his home down. I think he's still based in Merseyside. The good thing about Inverness is, which is an attraction to a lot of players who end up there, is the airport is at Inverness, which makes things a little bit easier. But no, it'll be interesting to see how he does. You know, I saw his interview on the TV last night. I think it's many years, is it 30-odd, 40-odd years since he's been up here. I honestly can't remember. You know, it's a long...
92 he broke.
92 was 30 years, yeah. Mm. So, his record as a manager is certainly up for speculation, I've got to say.
Yes.
He went to Forest Green. He did a fantastic...
It's a double gamble, isn't it, from both sides?
It is. I've got to say, I mean... You just see Duncan Ferguson, and it is Everton, because he was with Everton for so long, and he finally makes a move to Forest Green, and you know, it was a tough gig for him. He didn't really set the heather on fire there. We don't know the reasons really for that, but to make a big change and come up to Inverness is a massive change for him. I mean, I've got to say, what does he actually know about the Championship? What does he know about Scottish football? He's going to have to learn pretty quickly, but he'll instill what he's done so well as a player, you know, the drive and determination. Yeah. You're looking for that from them. We said that on the Inverness team at the weekend that played Dundee United. They should be doing better than they actually are. So I think that should give him hope that he can... It's always bad, Alan, when you go to a club and the players are at the bottom, and they're at the bottom for a reason, you know. They're really a poor, poor side. But I don't see that with Inverness. They've still got good players there. So he's just got to point them in the right direction. But I do have to say, a 3-year contract for a club who's is struggling.
Any championship club given a 3-year contract.
I've never seen that before, George. Yeah. You know, it's really surprising. So that, I mean, they put their heads
Scottish football talking. It's people in England talking. It's great that way, but it's a gamble, isn't it?
Well, yep. We've seen that before. I mean, when Dundee brought Boyer in last season, you know, who is this guy? But he had a vast amount of managerial experience, and you saw that got him through that. So I think it could go two ways with Inverness. Either we see a rapid improvement, or, you know, it could all go Pete Tom. I'm being honest with you.
Yeah, it's all fine and well saying it's attracted attention, and absolutely, and that is a good thing for a championship club. And in terms of attracting players as well, and his contacts and within the game are bound to be absolutely fantastic. But see, all that fades away the moment.
Right now, it's good to be speaking about it here.
Yeah, come December, if he's only won a couple of games and they're 5 points adrift at the bottom of the league, suddenly the fact that Talk Sport are interested in speaking to him and Sky Sports News have mentioned Inverness on their yellow ticker means absolutely nothing. So that's where the substance will kick in. And as Bear rightly says, it's so difficult to judge that managerial substance. Coaching substance clearly is there. You don't get kept around by Carlo Ancelotti and Rafa Benitez and Roberto Martinez for window dressing.
He was just scared of him. He would be the first one to be dunked.
I don't know. I think Carlo can probably handle himself.
Carlo would be okay.
He's clearly a gifted coach in terms of management. This, you know, second chance, and it's another challenging one, it really is. But what I would say is I agree with Bear. I think Inverness Cali's squad is far stronger in the context of the championship than Forest Green Rovers was in the context of League One in England. So it should give them a better crack at the whip. But
they've still been very, very poor, though. If they won a game this season, I don't think.
They've not. Even in the League Cup. No, I think the boys up north were saying it's 10 games without a win in all competitions. So,
big job.
Yeah, it is a tough one. Time will tell, but it won't be dull, and his interviews have already been really entertaining and he's a big character, and championships it's a great division for drama and narrative that he'll just add to it.
Dick Campbell was his opponent at the weekend for his first game. I mean,
at least they'll understand each other.
Exactly.
Anyway, after this red card.